It's my turn after two great speakers and two great talks, so congratulations for that. So let's see how it goes now. I was actually not expecting a small screen, and I will be sharing some code. The good thing is the slides are public, and I will share the URL later, so you can read probably the details you may miss from my presentation. And yeah, probably at this stage, everyone in this room knows IAC comes from infrastructure as code. But during this talk, my objective is just to share some information about the infrastructure as code, the current approaches, some solutions, so you can get your own idea of where we are standing now in front of infrastructure as code, and the best approach that maybe fits your needs or the different combinations you can find. So as an overview of today's session, we are, thank you. Now we are just introducing the talk. I will introduce a little bit where infrastructure as code stands. Then we will review several solutions from a historical perspective or per provider perspective. Then I will compare two specific approaches or two specific solutions. And finally, I will also share some thoughts on this area. And one question you may have, who am I today? This is Daniel Caballero. I'm working for Fastly. I'm a remote engineer from Barcelona. I'm doing some talks in La Salle University at Barcelona too about DevOps. And previously I was working for Schibsted that had an office here at London, so maybe you already know about Schibsted. It's a Scandinavian company behind several marketplaces and a media sites, entity, Oracle, so I'm back to the red color. And I also try to eventually contribute a little bit to the open source software, mostly with small patches. And a specific project that it's tcpgoon, that it's a TCP stressed check. What the fuck? That's okay. Hopefully that will close. And that's open source software, so if you want to take a look, feel free. And who knows Fastly in this room? So maybe half of the attendees. So I will be very quick introducing the company. Fastly, it's an edge cloud provider. So that means we have a distributed platform with POPs in several locations, with the final aim of speeding up the user perception of the web pages or just HTTP contents. And for that, we have a lot of infrastructure to manage. And I'm working in a team that is developing tools, developing services to manage the networking infrastructure in these locations. So this connects to this talk because we are also cloud users. So normally managing your infrastructure from your own infrastructure is not ideal. So we are also placing some services in other cloud providers. And most of the information in this talk comes from something like an internal small research where we were looking at different solutions. And I thought that generated some materials that can be useful for other teams. So first of all, infrastructure, cloud applications. Why now are you talking about infrastructure management when everyone is just using cloud? So someone else is managing your infrastructure. Why is something you should care? And also, we have seen also in the previous talks, Kubernetes is now a very common choice to deploy your applications and to run your applications. So Kubernetes is about abstracting your actual infrastructure. Why do you need to care about infrastructure as code? And I will use this diagram. It's something like a simple, let's say, internet or cloud application that lives on top of a cloud provider. So cloud provider is in the bottom. Normally, the cloud providers, they have a big portfolio of solutions, and some of these solutions are network-related or compute or storage-related. And probably your application, in order to be reachable, you need to interact with a DNS provider that maybe is your own, the same top provider for that you are using for the rest of services. You may also need some load balancing solution to make that service visible for the rest of the world. Finally, you may have applications maybe running directly in virtual machines in your provider, so it's something like GCE or EC2 in Amazon, or maybe you are using Kubernetes. That normally is not a 100% managed solution, so that means you also need to spawn your cluster, maintain your cluster. And finally, you may want to store your data in some backend services. You also need to create your own instance of that managed services service. You need to configure your own instance. So the message here is your application by itself is normally not very useful. You need a set of dependencies. So you normally want to configure your infrastructure so your application is useful. And also in Kubernetes, you need we have already seen some strategies to manage manifests, and you also need to declare there the your application dependencies, and you may want to use infrastructure as code for this matter. So yeah, at this stage, infrastructure is still everywhere. Unless you are a super lucky user and platform as a service works for you for most of your use cases, and this platform as a service is making your life super easy, you normally need to care about the infrastructure you need to use. So because of that, let's review some potential solutions helping you to manage that infrastructure. And we will start by the most popular choice for as a cloud provider that nowadays is AWS. And also, let's say, from a basic and older perspective to a new one. At the very beginning, Amazon released their services with completely API support. And actually, the user interface used to be less usable than the API. So most of the features were available in the API, but not in the interface. They were catching up on that. But in any case, one way to interact with that API was to use a library for your language. In this case, Boto is the SDK for Amazon in Python. And we will be using this example again and again, that it's the creation of an S3 bucket. And yeah, it's not a complex matter, just using API calls, in this case, reusing Boto. And in this case, actually, we also upload some content to that bucket. However, something to highlight about this approach is completely programmatic, but also is not declarative, so you need to say to your provider what you need to deploy, in which order, and all this overhead relies on you. So Amazon quickly react to this, and they release CloudFormation, that it's, let's say, a mechanism helping you to manage infrastructure stacks. And you define a configuration using their schema. And thanks to this, you get their services deployed with that specific configuration, but also supports updating these stacks to the desired state you are defining in the configuration file. So CloudFormation comes with an schema and also with a CLI tool to upload the stacks. That's a declarative approach. It's configuration driven. And it's a bit verbose, but for Amazon, it works, and it's a very common choice. But given that was pretty static, so yeah, CloudFormation accepts variables, and you can play a little bit with that. Now they also support YAML. A lot of people found out that adding additional dynamism to CloudFormation was convenient, and because of that, Troposphere was released as an open source tool. So essentially, it's just a library for Python allowing you to deploy CloudFormation files. So in this case, again, we have the S3 creation, an S3 bucket with an access control. Also an output variable you can use to connect to other parts of the infrastructure. But Troposphere does not deploy CloudFormation for you. You just create the CloudFormation after executing this piece of code, and then CloudFormation is the one that cares about the deployment. So Stepter comes to the rescue. It's a CLI tool allowing you to, given a set of CloudFormation files, a set of configurations for each of your environment, it allows you to, let's say, deploy or generating also CloudFormations where needed. To your provider. So it's only, again, it's only Amazon. And in this case, it's not a tool to define your configuration. You still need CloudFormation or Troposphere, but it helps you driving the deployment process of that configuration. And finally, something I just discovered a few days ago, it's still in beta version, is the Amazon Cloud Development Kit. And again, it's in this case, it's a programmatic approach, but to define in a declarative fashion your desired configuration. And looks very similar to Troposphere. In this case, they support, one difference is they support different programming languages. So in this case, we are using Python again, but there are three or four languages currently supported, and probably that will expand soon. And thanks to this, you can, let's say, get rid of the big CloudFormation definitions and do that by code, also with the benefits of adding dynamism, being able to push information from APIs. So that's something that probably is going to be very popular in just a matter of months. So, yeah, very similar to Troposphere, multi-language, and also maintained by Amazon, while Troposphere is community-driven. Breaking all the best practices, I created this slide just yesterday evening, and just to summarize what we have seen so far, so the different solutions, if they are declarative or imperative, if they incorporate a deployment tool, if they are configuration-driven or programmatic, and finally the language they support. So now we change of provider, GCP, that now is also a quite common choice as an alternative to Amazon, and what do we have in GCP to define this infrastructure? So something very similar to CloudFormation, it's the Google Deployment Manager. They support YAML by default, I think also JSON, and there you can define again you can define again your desired configuration with a plus that by default the deployment tool can also run Python code to generate that definition. So in this example, we are just deploying some KMS stuff. But the point here is the deployment manager will care about converting this into an actual manifest and deploying that into your project. So with that, you cover the same than CloudFormation, but also combine it with Troposphere or Google Cloud or the CDK, the Cloud Development Kit. Then, given we are talking about infrastructure, we should also touch Kubernetes. Kubernetes, by default, we already touched, you need to be filling up very verbose manifests. But probably nowadays, not so much people is still working only with manifests. Given it's quite raw, it's quite static, and easily you start embedding, variables, and in this case, it's just a piece of a bash script that given a variable with a here doc, we replace the specific version we want to release. But this is like the poor man solution, and Helm is the common choice to add this dynamism to your manifest. So using Golang, you use the templating functionality in Golang to replace and to inject a specific configuration in your manifests. However, it's not the only choice. The first speaker already mentioned that Customize is there. Customize was released last year also by the Kubernetes people. And it brings a different and slightly different approach to Helm. Instead of defining, a template and then some configuration to apply on top of that template, you just define something like a hierarchy of templates. So you can use something like inheritance in order to generate the final manifest you want to deploy. Customize generates manifests, so you still need kubectl to apply the changes, but you can easily, have a based manifest and then just replace, for instance, some specific configuration with a smaller piece of code. And then there's also Captain. Captain is not, I think it's not so new, but it's inheriting a lot of work, people was doing on top of JSONNet. And in the end, they use a programmatic approach, but specific for JSON, in order to incorporate dynamics to your manifest. So JSONNet is a programming language, but only, let's say, with one specific objective, that it's generating JSON files. And Captain does not provide a deployment tool. It's just the framework to generate the manifest and then inject that via kubectl, for instance. And finally, the last section is about multi-cloud, because everyone needs a multi-cloud. And the presentation now is a bit outdated, given Terraform released their 0.12 version just a couple of weeks ago. But most of the messages are still valid. The snippets are B12 compatible. And in this case, we have, again, an S3 creation example, an S3 bucket creation example. Terraform uses a specific configuration language, the HashiCorp configuration language, in order to define your infrastructure configuration. And with the latest version, they also support now JSON, so you can define with a similar schema a JSON file that will be equivalent to a configuration manifest like this. And Terraform is not opting to abstract all the different cloud providers. It's just a common mechanism to interact with your providers, but you will still need specific configuration for each provider and specific, in the end, logic, depending on your provider capabilities. Actually, Fastly also has a module for Terraform, so if you want to interact with Fastly API, you can also define the configuration via Terraform. And so then what happened with Terraform? Terraform is the common choice for a lot of companies, but again, it's pretty static. If you want to make dynamic things, you normally struggle a little bit with the specific configuration language. And there are some guys that created the Terrascript that benefits from the JSON support of the latest version of Terraform. So via Python, they offer some abstractions of, for instance, in this case, AWS instances. So just calling some functions, you will generate a JSON file you can deploy via Terraform. So it's more or less like a troposphere for CloudFormation. So in this case, TerraScript acts or has the same role. And finally, a project that I've been following since last year is Pulumi. And Pulumi is, again, it's a multi-cloud solution. It inherits a big portion of its API actually from Terraform. So they generate the API by, let's say, converting part of the Terraform schema to code. And it's a multi-language solution. So in this example, we are using Golang, but they also support Python and TypeScript, JavaScript. And in the end, you define your desired configuration, and Pulumi also cares about the deployment. We will see this solution a little bit more in detail later, but a big summary of the solutions we have seen in this area: Terraform, TerraScript, and Pulumi, which one is declarative, which one incorporates the deployment tool, and what's more configuration-driven or programmatic. So the last, let's say, technical portion of the talk, it's about comparing two approaches, and in this case, I wanted to benchmark Terraform against Pulumi. Now there are newer versions of the two tools, but they are quite more or less the same. Not 100% the same, because Terraform brings, with the latest version, they bring some looping capabilities we have all missed in the previous versions of their schema. And some actual examples of how the infrastructure as code looks in one with one technology or the other. In this case, the bucket creation example with some properties. In the top, you have the Terraform configuration, and in the bottom, an equivalent Pulumi snippet. And I was already pointing the data structures look quite the same, but with the benefit here, you have code. You can test probably your code, and you can make that completely dynamic. A bit more complex example. I don't know if you can actually read the code. Hopefully, at least a big part of the audience yes. In this case, another Terraform snippet. That creates a GKE cluster, so a Kubernetes cluster in Google. And it's probably not the best example because we are not using multi-zonal clusters. In this case, it's a cluster that which API lives in a specific zone. And then we have several, we are expanding the node pool, so the compute capacity, to different zones in the same region. So one thing I think is something like an anti-pattern in this configuration file is we are actually hard-coding some specific provider properties. So in order to deploy in multiple zones, the schema points you to inject the zone names, while probably you, everything you want is, I want a specific region and just take the zones for me. However, the framework does not help you too much in this specific case. While in Pulumi, it's given its code, actually this code is hiding part of the logic, but it's equivalent to the previous one. So you may want to, let's say, configure a specific base zone and then automatically discover the rest of regions, the rest of zones you have in that specific region. And that's possible because when you build the stack definition, you can actually interact with the Google API and fill up all the gaps you may need. Also, another typical example of the benefits of that is you can discover your dependencies, you can discover specific properties rather than incorporating that to your configuration file or just having to repeat yourself by injecting that configuration manually. Then, I already pointed that Terraform didn't used to be the best solution to do things like looping. In this case, we are creating two Amazon instances, and we are assigning one Elastic IP to each of them. And if you want to do some data transformation, you have some functions for that. But, well, actually, this line is still longer, but you need to combine them with some magic and with an with data-specific configuration capabilities in order to have a loop that acts differently depending on the iteration. And you know, if you want to reference objects you are creating in a specific with a specific resource, you need to play with the referencing specific items so that, let's say, from a readability perspective, does not look ideal. And in Pulumi, you are using an actual programming language. The programming languages, they have support for loops, for data transformation. So that becomes, I'm not saying better or worse, but at least more readable for anyone who have ever played, in this case, with Golang. So you have a standard iteration, and inside the iteration, you can have, in this case, we are blacklisting. That is equivalent to the other snippet. We are blacklisting a specific zone, and then deploying instances in the rest. And another functionality that looks interesting from Pulumi is they also give you in their library the capacity of building Docker images and also defining manifests you can inject into the Kubernetes API. So thanks to these two primitives, building a container and then generating a manifest, you can have your whole application delivery flow defined by Pulumi code. By the way, I'm not paid by Pulumi. I'm not an investor of Pulumi. It's just I was probably a previous Troposphere user, and having to adapt to static configuration files is a hard thing when you are used to benefit from the programming language capabilities. And yeah, so if you took the code approach, you can use the native capabilities to do abstraction, to reuse code, to extend code. So you have inheritance, mixing, interfaces, closures you can pass to your different functions. While that in Terraform, you can reuse some code thanks to modules, but it's not as flexible as using your programming language. In terms of testing, there's a link in the slides to a specific blog post that defines pretty well the how you can unit test your Pulumi code and also do some kind of functional tests given an stack you may want to deploy. But you can also introduce in your code things like compliance checks, so you cannot avoid generating stacks that do not comply with some properties or some policies in your company. So one example, imagine you have an IPAM database, so a place, an API where you store all the IP addresses or the networks you have in your company. With Pulumi, for instance, when you are about to define or create a stack, you can interact with that API to confirm all the static IPs you are going to use are registered in that database, or maybe register that on the fly. But nothing, of course, is ideal. What's under the hood within Pulumi? So Pulumi, it's multi-language, but that multi-language, you pay a cost for that capability. That it's, you have something like a core daemon that does the actual logic, and then different gRPC clients that are the ones that actually interact with the daemon using your code to do the actual logic. So extending, adding additional functionality to Pulumi is not easy compared to something like Terraform, where you have a Golang CLI that it's probably easier to track. Also, the experience, depending on the programming language you choose to work with Pulumi, is also pretty different. So for instance, I started using the Golang library, given everyone now uses Golang, but I quickly realized that's not, for instance, now they still don't have, I think, documentation for their Golang library, so you end up quickly reviewing their code to understand what's happening. And also, if you want to chain different stacks and refer to configuration that maybe lives in a different stack, that's also quite tricky in several of the languages they offer. The experience is not the same, so I switched to Python, that it's probably a more stable library right now. And yeah, if you want to store the state of your stack in Terraform, you have several options. You can upload that to the platform, but also to Google Cloud buckets. You can also store your state in S3 buckets, and you have plenty of options. While in Pulumi, you can only store the state on disk, or in their platform, where with their enterprise, let's say, functionality. So yes, Terraform nowadays is almost a standard. Also, the latest version, let's say, mitigates some of the problems we used to have. And another good point is there are modules for almost everything. So if you want to deploy a specific application, there's a high chance you find a module in GitHub that you can reuse or extend for your specific need. So I would say this comparison is not a story of winners and losers. It's just two different approaches. One is more mature than the other, and each of them has their benefits and its problems. So just to close that talk, funny thing normally I see is people speaks about now we are in the moment of declarative infrastructure automation, so we are defining declarative configuration for our infrastructure. But what my view generally when I see a big manifest is, okay, that's another, it's going back to configuration files, and yeah, you only with one provider, but in the end, we are managing the infrastructure as we did 10 years ago, probably. Final messages or things I want to highlight from that talk is infrastructure as code still plays an important role when you are deploying cloud applications or cloud infrastructure. Kubernetes is not a magical solution. You still need to deal with your application dependencies. And there are alternatives to manifest and templating if you are not happy with that or if that is not enough for your need. But there is no perfect solution. Everything, it's you need to normally study each case and find the one that fits the best in your use case.